This evening is special because we have members of Congress from both sides of the aisle and both chambers coming together after 7 p.m. to enjoy themselves and maybe even have a cocktail with journalists. We have done here in this room what we have been told never happens in Washington anymore. Yes, I am talking to you, Chris Matthews. Journalists and politicians are getting together, and darn it, we are going to have fun. And if we're lucky, we will even make fools of ourselves tonight. And yes, while tonight is about having fun, what is the deal with the politicians beating the journalists at one of the things reporters are supposedly good at? Words. Both times we have done this event, a Congress member has won out over the reporters. Will this be the night that a journalist finally prevails? If not, I do have a suggestion. Next time, the politicians should invite the journalists to a policy bee. Yes, a policy bee. Journalists will then have an opportunity to beat politicians at their own game. Raise the debt ceiling. Pass a highway bill. Imagine the things journalists could accomplish if they are only given the chance. A policy bee. But right now, we're going to have a spelling bee. And to get the fun rolling, comedian Tim Young will join us in a couple moments. But first, we have this video that Tim has put together. Let's watch it now.
My name's Tim Young, and I'm the comic performing tonight. I'm also a professional spelling bee coach. Now, Senator Kaine was serious about defending his title this year, so his staff hired me to keep his spelling skills fresh.
So how does one go about becoming a professional spelling coach?
First, you need money. Like you don't have any money. Then, you reply to a Craigslist ad.
Tim who? The spelling bee coach? No idea what he does here. He just kind of sits around and then occasionally tells people to spell things. It really doesn't make any sense. Especially in staff meetings. Please don't tell me you pay.
I've been training really hard to make sure that I don't lose my crown. Winning the National Spelling Bee, the Centennial National Spelling Bee in 2013, was one of the great honors of my life. And I'm going to do everything possible to make sure that I repeat.
Spell it.
R-E-P-E-A-T.
Some people say I have no idea what I'm doing, that I have no business training a United States Senator and a spelling bee champion to win again. Those people are probably right.
Es como esta cámara puede debatir, ofrecer enmiendas, negociar y al final unirse que moverá nuestro país adelante.
¡Spella!
I don't have my, where are we at? There's one tech guy working tonight. God bless him. There we go. How's everybody doing tonight? Really doesn't sound like you drank enough yet, but we'll go with it. 102 years ago, the first spelling bee between Congress and press was held here. And it was hosted by Secretary of State William Jennings Bryan. What the hell happened? It's me now? Like what? Budget cuts. And so many things have changed. Since then, the club started letting women in. They started letting minorities in, I think, last year. Look around, seriously. And more importantly, some things have stayed the same. Like for the past 100 years, the CIA director has been using AOL email. (Laughter) I want to welcome, actually, one of my favorite people that I've known from TV for a very long time, Dr. Jacques Bailey, right here in the middle. Give him a round of applause, guys. He's the pronouncer for every one of the national spelling bees. And it's been, what, 15 years, something? How long have you been doing it for?
Oh, longer than that. I started in 91, but then I became pronouncer in 2003. So
Okay, I got 12 minutes. That's good. That's good. No, just... That's it's awesome though. He's like Alex Trebek stuck in the terrible category. But there's something I've always wanted to hear from you, and I've watched a lot of National Spelling Bees. There's something I've always wanted to hear you say. I yell it at the TV all the time, and I really want you to do this for everybody here in the audience, because I'm sure everyone in the audience who has watched a National Spelling Bee has said the same thing. Can you just say this for us? Funny fact about Dr. Bailey, he was actually Spelling Bee champion. Look at that fresh face, right? In 1980. Immigrating from Asia was a lot harder then. Nobody can see you laughing at that, it's okay. Let's talk about the press team really quickly. They brought out their heavy hitters. Angela Greiling, Keane, David Kerley, Rebecca. I don't want to read them all. It's tough to read. Listen, the first round, they're going to have to spell their own names. They're horrified by this. Look at the red lines up there. Those aren't words. And I've been asking around, how do you become a journalist? Step one, sign up for WordPress. Two, tweet incessantly in response to Democrat members of Congress. Three, write a 350-word piece about those tweets. Pay $5 on Facebook to promote that piece. And then you call the rest of the mainstream media lame. That doesn't sound right. Actually, that's how to become a Republican blogger. Before we get too into it, I was told, and I'm very excited by this, that we have two late entrants for the press team. Joining us right now from MSNBC, I want you guys to give a big round of applause for Rachel Maddow and Al Sharpton. Rachel Maddow and Al Sharpton! Is your microphone on? This needs to work for the bit.
I think so. Yeah, it's on. Thank you.
This is not Rachel Maddow and Al Sharpton.
Nope. No, this is Al Sharpton, and this one's Rachel. This one's Rachel Maddow. Yeah. We practiced this.
Yeah. Who are you trying to fool? This is pressing Congress here. What are you doing?
Listen, it's been a rough year at MSNBC. We need to win something. Just let us have this one.
Get out of here.
Yeah.
Get out of here.
Ah.
My favorite member tonight, of course, Congress is here tonight. Thank God they got some Republicans to come. Senator Flake, God bless him. He's not here yet, probably. But listen, there's one congressman in particular that I wanted to meet tonight, and I like to call him Congressman. Oh, I know Joe Biden so well that I can announce he's running for president. And by the way, things aren't looking so good because that's not how you spell president. It's not the first time he's pulled this off. There was this time. And then this one, too. I was told just before I came on that he actually has a broken leg. That's Delaware rules for you guys, Delaware rules. You lie, you get taken out. All right, listen. And there are mainly Democrats on the congressional team tonight, which means we're going to hear one of three excuses tomorrow once they lose. That one. It was too hot to concentrate because of climate change. And of course, they actually won the bee, but Steve, the cameraman, was seriously biased and heavily edited the videos. Let it sink in. There's actually already a hashtag campaign tomorrow that's going to come out. I stand with the congressional spelling team.
All right, a lot of Planned Parenthood fans here. Listen. I'd be remiss to not mention that it's Back to the Future Day. And, you know, there were a lot of advances that didn't come to life in that movie. You know, holographic hats, that really crappy animation of Jaws. My Mets are going to win tonight. Listen. I paused for the break there on that, and I forgot that you guys are nerds and don't watch sports. But the one that I actually, and let's get ready for this one, the one that I actually am glad did not happen, because we helped avoid a Hindenburg-like disaster with, is the flying car. In this instance, in particular,
Eleanor Holmes Norton is struggling to park her car right now.
And she has hit that red car next to her repeatedly.
And we're taking pictures.
Thank God we don't have flying cars. It's a great angle in the end. Listen, we all get bad pictures, all right? Let's talk about the Democrat debate last week. Was that last week? I don't know. I don't pay attention to things. It was Hillary Clinton and Bernie against three characters from an Abbott and Costello sketch. Who, what, and I don't know. Give me that one. We're out of creative on this, all right? My last little piece here. I couldn't get over this, and I want you to take a look at this. Hillary Clinton sponsored a post to wish Hillary Clinton a happy birthday. That sounds like something I've done. Especially as a little fat kid growing up at 8 years old, my parents used to pay people to come to my birthday. That's just a personal note for you guys to groan at. Listen, it's not just the Democrats that are having a rough time right now. And I want to leave you with this. It's the Republicans. And, you know, you have 17 candidates, you think you'd have a good one out of the lot. And there might be a good one. But I saw a commercial the other day that was just depressing. I don't know how to describe it, but I think it kind of sums up how things are right now.
Every day, candidates are losing hope. Whether it be when they started creepily filming their family, or when they not so heroically told a burglar in a Popeyes that he should shoot the cashier instead of him. No, he pretty much said that. Some of these GOP hopefuls have just lost hope. Sure, some of them have quirky gimmicks that we've come to know and love, or tolerate, or however you would describe that girl's reaction to him in this picture. But I mean, come on, posing with her, you didn't even get 100 retweets out of that. And conveniently enough for puns, this was just a swing and a miss. I can't even figure out which one of these people in the picture is the candidate. And I absolutely have no idea who this is. So won't you help them? Or something today?
Thank you guys so much. Enjoy the spelling bee. Thanks for being a good sport.
Thank you. Another round of applause for Tim. We are grateful tonight for the tremendous support from our sponsor, Discovery Communications. They are a great company that makes valuable contributions to global education, and we cannot think of a better sponsor for this event. Also, if you are tweeting tonight, remember the hashtag NPCB. And there's also NPC Live, which we use for every NPC event. But NPCB is the one we used 2 years ago, and it rather blew up Twitter. So feel free to have at it tonight. Some of the proceeds from this event are going to support our nonprofit affiliate, the National Press Club Journalism Institute. The Institute awards scholarships to aspiring journalists, retrains reporters who have lost their jobs, and fights for press freedom worldwide. Press freedom has been such an important priority for the club this year, with journalists like the Washington Post's Jason Rezaian being held in prison. And we are proud that tonight will help us continue that important work in press freedom. I want to thank the people at the Press Club who really made this event happen, and that is the National Press Club's Young Members Committee. Right now, yes, give it up. Right now, I want you to welcome the co-chairs of the Young Members Committee, Jen Judson of Defense News and Julia Piper of Green Tech Media.
Hello, everyone. Thanks so much for coming. Welcome to the National Press Club's Politicians versus Press Spelling Bee for 2015. I'm Julia Piper. This is Jen Judson. We are the co-chairs of the Young Members Committee here at the Press Club. I want to thank a few people to start this off. First, the Press Club staff who worked with us tirelessly, especially Sarah Ann Driggs, who works directly with the Young Members Committee. She worked through every detail with us. Also, members of our subcommittee who put this on, Rachel Oswald, who we said that she trick-or-treated for lawmakers. She went on Capitol Hill and got everyone to show up here pretty much. So thank you, Rachel, as well as Sean McMinn, Ellen Mitchell, and Scott Massioni, and really everyone. And thank you guys for coming. And we'd also like to thank Discovery Communications for your generous support of the Bee. And last but not least, the Scripps National Spelling Bee for making this event happen and conducting the competition tonight. Also, be sure to sign up to win free tickets to the upcoming Arena Stage production of Akilah and the Bee. It's based on the classic heartwarming film Akilah and the Bee, about an 11-year-old girl from the Chicago Projects who dreams of competing in the Scripps National Spelling Bee. This world premiere play appears at the Arena Stage from mid-November through the end of December. The drawing sign-up is just outside of the ballroom, but by the check-in table, and so thank you to Arena Stage for generously raffling off the tickets. Now it's time to get to the main event. So we'd like to bring in our competitors. So over here, I think you can guess these are our lawmakers. First, I'd like to introduce Virginia Democrat Senator Tim Kaine. He is here to defend his title as the reigning best speller in the United States. No pressure. Next, we have Arizona Republican Senator Jeff Flake. Yeah. And Democratic Representative Don Beyer. And California Democrat Rep. Ted Lieu. Nebraska Democratic Representative Brad Ashford. Minnesota Republican Representative Tom Emmer. And New Jersey Democrat Representative Bill Pascrell.
All right. Now, on the journalist team, we have ABC correspondent David Kerley. Rod Kuckro with Energy Wire, E&E News. Angela Greiling Keane, White House correspondent for Bloomberg, and a former Press Club president. Nice. Yochi Dreazen, He's managing editor at Foreign Policy. Editor, watch out. He knows. Washington Post, Karen Demirjian. We have Nick Gass with Politico. He'll also be live tweeting the entire event. No. Ellen Ferguson, a reporter for Congressional Quarterly Roll Call. And Clinton Yates, a columnist for The Washington Post. I'm now going to introduce the wonderful team from Scripps that came in here. They put on the actual spelling bee. They're here to moderate tonight. Dr. Jacques Bailey, a professor at Vermont University, pronouncer for the Scripps National Spelling Bee. Thank you. We have Corey Leifler, associate producer. We have judge and executive producer of the Scripps National Spelling Bee, Paige Kimball. Helping us out tonight on record keeping, we have Beth Hickey and Lori Morris. And now I'm truly honored to get to announce these next two folks here tonight. It's Gokul Venkatachalam and Vanya Shivashankar. These are the actual best spellers in the United States. I'm going to hand it over to them. They know the rules better than anyone else. They're going to explain to you all how tonight's going to go. This is the last you'll hear from us for a little while. Enjoy the show.
Hi, everyone. As Jen and Julia said, I'm Paige Kimball. I'm executive director of the Scripps National Spelling Bee. And for this one night, I get to be a spelling bee judge. And we have?
Howdy, y'all. I'm Jacques Bailey. I teach Greek and Latin at the University of Vermont most of the time. I'm a proud father of two. Happy to be here.
So Jen and Julia asked us to come up and explain the rules, and we think everyone is here for spelling and would rather hear just a little bit about the most important rules from the champs themselves. So with that, I give you Vanya and Gokul.
Hi, I'm Gokul.
And hi, I'm Vanya. So we wanted to review some quick rules with you that you might want to know about the bee. First of all, if you misspell once, that's okay. I will just be ringing this bell, and it sounds like this.
And if you misspell your second time, you're actually out, and you'll be hearing the sound.
Just enjoy the bee. Competitors, remember to take your time, ask questions. Anything else you want to
add? Good luck.
Yeah. Thank you.
First speller is David Kerley. Am I live here? First speller is David Kerley.
Yeah.
Senator Kaine, you are going down, not by me, but by some of my colleagues. Dr. Bailey, could you spell my name correctly without looking at it, please?
I could, yes.
You know, we have these things called IFB. Guys, just right in the ear.
Ambiguity.
Ambiguity.
Yes, as in one warning sign when buying a car is when there is ambiguity in the salesman's answer to the question, does it run?
I do cover transportation. Ambiguity. Take your time, right? A-M. B. G-U-I-T-Y. See? I knew I wouldn't last long. I'm a broadcaster.
Ambiguity.
I just have to know how to say it.
Ambiguity is spelled A-M-B-I-G-U-I-T-Y.
I thought about the I. Let it go by. I, me, you.
Okay.
Do I get to sit down now and wait another time, or
yeah,
do I have to keep on going?
You gotta wait for the next one.
It won't last very long, everybody.
You can have a seat.
Yep. Senator Kaine.
I am pleased to represent this incredibly diverse congressional team here. We span the spectrum of America from A to B, and I'm glad to be here to defend my title. So.
Veterinarian.
V-E-T-E-R-A-N-A-R-I-A-N. Oh, I missed an R.
Veterinarian is V-E-T-E-R-I-N-A-R-I-A-N. Mr. Kuckro?
This is like one of those movies where you watch your colleagues walk up to the gallows and wonder how they're going to react when the door drops out. Okay, hit me.
Rudimentary.
R-U-D-I-M-E-N-T-A-R-Y.
Correct. Senator Flake.
Now, as the only Republican up there on this side, and probably that side too, I have to be among the last two, right? No? Just don't give me speaker. We can't spell speaker either. So, anyway.
Chastisement.
Ouch. C-H. I thought she was reaching for the bell. C-H-A-S-T-I-S-M-E-N-T. There it goes.
Chastisement is spelled C-H-A-S-T-I-S-E-M-E-N-T. Greiling.
All right, so I agreed to do this, and then I remembered that the farthest I ever made it in a spelling bee when I was younger than these kids was in like fourth and fifth grade when I went out on the words chocolate and cheddar. So hopefully nothing harder than that.
How about boondoggle?
We know how to spell that.
Boondoggle, as in, with the help of a flash flood and an overserved uncle, the wedding quickly dissolved into a boondoggle.
Boondoggle. B-O-O-N-D-A-G-L-E? No.
Boondoggle is spelled B-O-O-N-D-O-G-G-L-E. Representative Lieu.
Can I Google these words that you give me? Go ahead.
Ready?
Yep.
Bankruptcy.
B-A-N-K-R-U-P-T-C-Y.
Correct. Mr. Dreazen.
To proper height.
Provocative.
Provocative. P-R-O-V-O-C-A-T-I-V-E.
Correct.
Ready.
Ready?
I think.
Artesian.
Artesian. A-R-T-E-S-I-A-N.
Correct.
I do have the hardest name to spell in this competition, right?
So, hi, Karen. Sure. How do you say your last name?
Demirjian. It's like emergency, but with a D on the front and minus the C at the end.
Okay.
Demirjian. I've rehearsed that many times over. What? I know, right?
Spell it?
Well, it's spelled differently, so I guess it doesn't quite count, but.
Venison.
One more time?
Venison, the flesh of a deer.
I've heard of it. V-E-N-I-S-O-N.
Correct.
Thanks. Yeah. I haven't spelled anything since 88, so.
Okay.
Thank you, though.
Tertiary.
T-E-R. T-I-A-R-Y.
Correct.
Short.
Subterfuge.
Subterfuge. S-U-B-T-E-R-F-U-G-E.
I just want the senator to know I'm a Republican. I'm sitting right down there. And by the way, in the Senate, you probably could spell speaker if you just take the damn bill up, but that's a different issue. It's all fair here. It's all fun and games. Okay, wait. All right, I'm ready. You guys didn't say we couldn't have, all right.
Tantamount.
Oh, no.
T.
A-N-T. A-M-O-U-N-T. Tantamount.
Correct. Howdy. Ready?
As ever, whatever. I can't even speak. How am I going to spell?
Nostalgia.
Nostalgia. I'm a former regional reporter, so I've covered spelling bees. Could you give me that in a sentence?
Theo was overcome with nostalgia at the sight of a McDonald's in Istanbul.
Could you pronounce that again, please?
Nostalgia.
Nostalgia. Nostalgia. N-O-S-T-A-L-G-I-A.
Correct.
I represent Peter Zenger for all of you. Freedom of the press is what we're all about, right? Give me some liberty on this, will you please?
Limousine.
You gotta be kidding me. Okay, let me see. Limousine, L-I-N-O. S-E-N-E? Z-E-N-E? T-E-N-E?
Limousine is spelled L-I-M-O-U-S-I-N-E.
Couple weeks, maybe a couple days ago, I was here to see Ben Carson speak right at this place, and now that I see this panel, I sort of feel like him now, too. All right, let's go.
Fitting word, antithesis.
Antithesis. Antithesis. A-N-T-I-T-H-E-S-I-S. Antithesis.
That's the end of round one. Journalists, 6. Lawmakers, 4. Okay, this will be the first of our themed rounds. This round's theme is the Declaration of Independence. So, David Kerley, please join us at the mic.
It is without ambiguity that I return to this podium.
Are you unanimous in that?
I am unanimous. You and I.
Your word is magnanimity, as in, observers praised the congressman's magnanimity in not doing his traditional happy dance when the bill passed.
Magnanimity. M-A-G-A-N-I-M-T-Y. Oh, he's out of here. I told you I'd only last for 2.
Matt. Magnanimity is spelled M-A-G-N-A-N-I-M-I-T-Y. So I think once you get that bell, you can join the audience.
Thank you. Hey, save me a seat over there.
Accustomed.
Wait, which constitution are we talking about?
This is the Declaration of Independence.
Oh, that constitution. Yeah. Accustomed. A-C-C-U-S-T-O-M-E-D.
Correct. Unalienable.
U-N-A-L-I-E-N-A-B-L-E.
Correct. Dissolutions.
Give me that in the long story.
After the debate club was the 5th organization to disband in 1 year, the members of the student council stated they would stand for no further dissolutions.
Disillusions.
Dissolutions. This is terminations or destructions by breaking down, disrupting, or dispersing. Dissolutions.
D-I-S-A-L-L-U-S. I-O-N.
Dissolutions is spelled D-I-S-S-O-L-U-T-I-O-N-S. Howdy. Despotism.
I've always wanted to say this, and I may get out on this round, so can I have the etymology of that, please?
Ah. Despotism is from an originally Greek word that passed into French before becoming English. As in, Omar's final civics essay argued that Mr. Stevens' class operated as a system of despotism and should be broken into three branches of government, one of which being the boys in the back row.
Despotism. D-E-S-P-O-T-I-S-M.
Correct. Sufferance. This means patient endurance.
S-U-F-F-E-R-A-N-C-E.
Correct. Okay. Usurpations.
Usurpations. U-S-U-R-P-A-T-I-O-N-S.
Correct. Barbarous.
Barbarous. B-A-R-B-A-R-O-U-S.
Yes. Correct. Tyranny.
Tyranny? I always used to think it was funny that people wrote on their hand when I watched it, but on television, but it helps. T-Y-R-A-N-N-Y.
Correct.
Okay, great. Here we are. I have to raise this up a little bit. So.
Okay. Appropriations.
That's the side I'm on.
As in, the senator demanded to know who had written "Miss" in front of appropriations on the door of his yes. committee meeting.
Let's all reason together on this. Appropriations. A-P-P-R-O-P-R-A. A-P-P-R-O-P-R-I-A. T-I-O-N-S.
Appropriations is spelled A-P-P-R-O-P-R-I-A-T-I-O-N-S.
What did I say?
You can't change the spelling. That's Providence. This is a singular noun. It means divine guidance or care. Providence.
Providence. P-R-O-V-I-D-E-N-C-E.
Jeff Flake, please forgive me. I am the only Republican up here. I'm sorry. Please forgive me. Please forgive me. It's all right. I got to make hay while the sun's shining because I'm not long for this thing, I can tell.
Okay. Acquiesce.
Pass. Acquiesce. A C Q. U E I S. Huh. E. There was another S, wasn't there?
There's a C.
Oh, yeah. Two.
A C Q U I E S C E. Consanguinity. as in the consanguinity of supermodel Kate Upton and her uncle Fred Upton, is the subject of Tom's first screenplay, titled Beauty and the Chairman of the House Energy Committee.
Oh, I think I'm going to make you run through the full gamut here.
Okay.
All right. Country of origin?
Consanguinity is from Latin.
Consanguinity?
Consanguinity.
Consanguinity.
Sounds right.
Well, what's the latitude and longitude of a country's of origin? Okay, consanguinity.
Yes, it means the quality or state of being related by blood.
Consanguinity. C-O-N-S-A-N, consanguinity. G-Q-U-I-T-Y.
Consanguinity is spelled C-O-N-S-A-N-G-U-I-N-I-T-Y.
Ah, okay.
Undistinguished.
Undistinguished. U-N-D-I-S-T-I-N-G-U-I-S-H. E-D. Yeah.
I have a history question. Is consanguinity what they used to determine like how royal lines were determined and all that in terms of how people were related to each other? Is that why that word is of importance?
Yep.
Like in
that's
history?
What it means? Okay. Consanguinity.
Just wondering if that's where I knew that.
Okay. You got to spell a new word, though.
Thank God.
Inhabitants. Inhabitants.
Inhabitants? Inhabitants?
Yes, a plural noun. People who dwell or reside permanently in a place.
Inhabitants. I-N-H-A-B-I-T-A-N-T-S, inhabitants.
Correct. At the end of round two, we have journalists 12, lawmakers 8. We'll have yet another themed round this time. The theme is Back to the Future 2. So, do we start with Senator Kaine?
Cubs, C-U-B-S.
Pedestrians.
Can you repeat again?
Pedestrians.
Plural.
It's a plural noun. It's people who travel on foot, walkers. As in, the newscast ended with a breaking story about a poodle who walked on 2 feet alongside startled pedestrians.
Poodle. P E D E S T R I A N S.
Correct.
Stop that, will you?
Paradox.
P-A-R-A-D-O-X.
Correct. Capacitor. As in, Miriam tried to pawn her father's 8-track player, telling the young clerk it was actually a flux capacitor.
Capacitor. C-A-P-A-C-I-T-O-R.
Correct.
Nice.
Yeah. Penitentiary.
Penitentiary. Can you use it in a sentence?
The judge sentenced the convicted felon to 10 years in a federal penitentiary.
It's a little close to home.
P-E-N-I-T-E-N-T-I-A-R-Y.
Very good. Correct. Instantaneously.
Instantaneously.
As in, the judge's bell instantaneously shattered the journalist's dream of being America's best speller.
I-N-S-T-A-N-T-A-N-E-O-U-S-L-Y.
Correct. Gigawatts.
I know. G-I-G-A-W-A-T-T-S.
Correct.
I feel good about it, yeah.
Ready?
Short. Short word.
Continuum.
C-O-N-T-I-N-U-U-M.
Correct. Submarine.
Submarine?
Submarine.
Can I just have the definition to make sure?
A submersible ship armed with torpedoes, guns, and missiles.
Okay. S-U-B-M-A-R-I-N-E.
Was I the last Republican here? Are you ready? I am.
Okay. Almanac.
Oh, gosh. A-L-M-A-N-A-C.
Correct. Dilapidated.
Definition?
Decayed, deteriorated, injured, or fallen into partial ruin, especially because of neglect or misuse. Dilapidated.
Dilapidated. D-I-L-A-P-I-D-A-T-E-D.
Very good.
Correct. Scenario. Or scenario.
S-C-E-N-A-R-Y.
Scenario is spelled S-C-E-N-A-R-I-O.
Oh, I had the wrong word. I'm sorry.
Can you stay on stage? Congressman Pascrell? The problem is, it's standing room only out there, so you can't join the audience.
It's on a jumbotron out of the mall.
Okay. Hello.
Hello.
Gravitational.
Gravitational?
Gravitational.
Gravitational. Can you use that in a sentence, please?
If the gravitational force of Earth were turned off momentarily, we would all get a free ride into space.
Gravitational. Gravitational. G-R-A-V-I. Gravitational?
Gravitational.
Okay. G-R-A-V-I. T-A. Gravitational? Because that writing on the hand thing does nothing for me. All right, G-R-A-V-I. What did I say? G-R-A-V-I-T-A, gravitational. T-I-O-N-A-L.
Correct.
Accepting the award for best supporting actress.
Mr. Yates.
Bonjour.
Bonjour. Temporal.
Temporal. T E M P O R A L.
Correct. Temporal. The end of round three, we have journalists 19, lawmakers 13. Okay, we're going to have another themed round. The theme of this round is U.S. demonyms.
U.S. what?
Demonyms.
Come on.
You'll see what we mean. Senator Kaine.
Can I ask what the score is again after that last round?
Journalists, 19. Lawmakers, 13.
You guys, it's like they use words for a living over on this side. I mean, it's incredible. Okay.
Connecticutter. Or Connecticutter. A native or resident of the state of Connecticut.
C-O-N-N-E-C-T-I-C-U-T-T-E-R.
Connecticutter is spelled C-O-N-N-E-C-T-I-C-U-T-E-R.
What's a denonym?
A demonym?
Yeah.
Named after a place.
All right.
Michigander.
Michigander. M-I-C-H-I-G-A-N-D-E-R.
Louisianian.
Can you say that again?
Louisianian or Louisianian?
I'd like to do a motion to vacate that word. Did you use it in a sentence?
I don't think we have a parliamentarian here. The Louisianian spoke with reverence about the way his neighbors rebuilt after the hurricane.
L-O-U-S-I-A-N. I-A-N.
Louisianian is spelled L-O-U-I-S-I-A-N-I-A-N. Mississippian.
Mississippian. M-I-S-S-I-S-S-I-P-V-I. A-N.
Correct.
New Yorker?
Nope. Wisconsinite. The Wisconsinite enjoyed living in Madison, but would she trade it for warmer weather in Phoenix? You
these
betcha.
These are words I've never seen on paper before. Wisconsinite, capital W-I-S-C-O-N. Let me start over again. So W-I-S-C-O-N-S-I-N-I-T-E.
Yes.
Correct. Missourian.
M-I-S-S-O-U-R-I-A-N.
Correct.
N-E-B-R. No, sorry. There aren't that many of us.
So. Hawaiian.
H-A-W. A I I A N.
Correct.
Although I'm willing to trade with him if I can't spell this one. So.
Delawarean.
Language of origin.
Delawarean is from a U.S. geographical name.
Are there any alternate pronunciations?
I find just the one, Delawarean. Might be regional ones.
What?
There might be regional pronunciations.
But we're not aware of those here.
No.
Okay, Delawarean. Well, D E L A W A R E A N.
Correct. Pennsylvanian.
Thank you for having me. Pennsylvanian. P-E-N-N-S-Y-L-V-A-N-I-A-N.
Correct.
It's really my turn this time. All right. Right?
I'm sorry?
It's my turn, right?
Yes, okay. It is this time.
All right.
Tennessean.
Tennessean. T-E-N-N-E-S-S-E-A-N.
We run out of them. Utahn.
Utahn. U-T-H-A-N. Oh.
Sorry. Utahn is U-T-A-H-N.
Okay. Thank you very much. I appreciate it.
Thank you.
Say it with me, gang. Taxation without representation.
Wyomingite.
Wyomingite. W-Y-O-M-I-N-G-I-T-E.
Correct. The end of round four, we have journalists, 25. Lawmakers, 16. We have another themed round this time. These are political words.
What was the score, the overall score of the two teams? You have that yet?
Oh, the score is 25 journalists and lawmakers 16. And I think we need to start with the journalists because the records desk has a certain order. So,
can I get the word he was going to get?
Just the next word on the list.
All right.
Gubernatorial.
Gubernatorial. This is not about your neighbors, right? Okay, nobody got that. Gubernatorial, G-U-B-E-R-N-A-T-O-R-I-A-L.
Be slow and clear if you can. Empleomania.
Can you use that in a word? In a sentence?
Sure. Empleomania is an excessive desire for holding public office. As in, Justin's empleomania led to impromptu stump speeches in the street, in schools, and in the forest on actual stumps.
I have no idea how to spell that word. F-R-E-E-J-A-S-O-N.
Empleomania is spelled Empleomania is spelled E-M-P-L-E-O-M-A-N-I-A. Ombudsman.
Ombudsman. O-M B-U D S M-A-N.
Correct.
The only Virginia Democrat up here.
Demagoguery.
Demagoguery. D E M A G O G U E R Y.
Very good.
Correct.
That was nicely done.
Interpellate. Or interpolate. Interpellate.
What are all the things I can ask for? Etymology, language of origin, using a sentence? That's
yes.
the whole ride.
Interpellate is originally from a Latin word. It means question formally about a governmental policy or decision. At the next student government meeting, the students will interpellate the principal and Jane, the lunch lady, about the sudden disappearance of Taco Tuesday.
Boy. I N T E R P E L A T E.
Oh.
Interpellate is spelled I-N-T-E-R-P-E-L-L-A-T-E.
Do it from my chair. Okay.
Kleptocracy.
I use that every day. What is it? Just to remind me how that would be used.
Kleptocracy is from originally Greek elements. It means government conducted by those who seek chiefly status and personal gain at the expense of the governed. The Neronian regime in Rome is sometimes cited as an example of a particularly atrocious kleptocracy.
C. L. Can't be this. C-L-E. P-T-O. C-R-A-C-Y.
Kleptocracy is spelled K-L-E-P-T-O-C-R-A-C-Y.
It's Greek. This member would not know what a kleptocracy is.
Referendum.
Referendum. Out of curiosity, language of origin?
Latin.
Okay, referendum. R-E-F-E-R-E-N-D-U-M.
I think I'm up. You might be all by yourself in a minute.
Doctrinaire.
Oh. Doctrinaire is what you said?
Doctrinaire.
D-O-C. T-R-A. N-A-I-R-E. Goodbye.
Doctrinaire is spelled D-O-C-T-R-I-N-A-I-R-E. Bureaucracy.
Bureaucracy?
Bureaucracy.
B? Go ahead.
The political consultant recommended that the candidate mention Washington bureaucracy no fewer than 200 times per speech.
Okay, so starting over, B-U-R-E-A-U-C-R-A-C-Y.
Great.
You see these drums? They're pretty sweet.
Yeah. Renvoi.
Language of origin, please.
It's from a French word, renvoi. It means the return by a government of a foreign-born resident to his or her own country.
Renvoi. R-E-N-V-O-I?
Correct.
I just wanted to make a quick announcement. We're clearly getting down to the final moments here. I mean, this is going to go on for another hour. Get comfortable. Well, speaking of that, just actually before anyone goes, remember to sign up, put a raffle in for the show. The arena stage performance is happening. You can throw a ticket in the raffle right outside while you get a drink. This will go on. Do not mistake me here. This is a couple more rounds to go. We clearly have journalists in the running. Just wanted to give you guys a reminder.
So at the end of round five, journalists 30, lawmakers 17. We'll have another themed round, U.S. inventions. So records desk, who are we? So Mr. Kuckro is first again.
We don't get a break to go to the... Okay. All right. Go ahead.
Cyclometer.
Cyclometer? Really?
Cyclometer, yes. It's a contrivance for recording the revolutions of a wheel and often used for registering distance traversed by a wheeled vehicle, as in, Chris attached a cyclometer to his daughter's tricycle and was baffled to discover she'd been making regular trips into the city.
Can I call a friend? Cyclometer, C-Y-C-L-O-M-E-T-E-R.
The only Democrat.
Sousaphone.
Sousaphone, wow. S-O-U-S-A-P-H-O-N-E.
Very good. Correct. Periscope.
Periscope. Language of origin?
It's made up of Greek-derived elements.
P-E-R-I-S-C-O-P-E.
Correct. Formica.
F-O-R-M-I-C-A.
Correct. Aerogel.
Could you tell me what that is? I've never heard of it before.
An aerogel is a highly porous solid formed by replacement of liquid in a semi-solid substance with a gas, so there is little shrinkage.
Are there any alternate pronunciations?
There's just the one, aerogel.
Aerogel? And what's the language of origin?
The first part is originally Greek, and the second part is from an element that went from Latin to Italian to French.
Can I ask you to repeat the definition one more time?
Yes. It's a highly porous solid formed by replacement of liquid in a semi-solid substance with gas so that there is little shrinkage.
Okay, aerogel. A-E-R-O-G-E-L?
Correct. Mimeograph.
Mimeograph. M-I-M-E-O-G-R-A-P-H.
Correct.
Let's go.
Trampoline.
Trampoline. T-R-A-M-P-O-L-I-N-E, trampoline.
At the end of round six, we have journalists 36, lawmakers 18. Have another themed round. This is American regional foods. Mr. Kuckro.
I can defer to the congressman, really. All right.
Bialy. It's a flat roll that has a depressed center and is usually covered with onion flakes, as in, Bialy may be dense and chewy, somewhat like a bagel, but definitely not a bagel, said the bagel.
What part of the country is this eating?
It's from Yiddish, which took it from a Polish geographical name, but it's from a New York.
All right. I mean. This is, I'm winging it. B-I-E-A-L-L-Y. B-I-E-A-L-L-Y. No.
Bialy is spelled B-I-A-L-Y. Ludafisk.
Can you use that in a sentence for me, please?
While lutefisk is originally Scandinavian, it is a regional food in the northern Great Lakes region.
So lutefisk. L-U-D-A-F-I-S.
Lutefisk is L-U-T-E-F-I-S-K.
I'm from Minnesota. I wanted lutefisk.
Gooey duck.
G-E-O-D-U-C-K.
Correct.
All right.
Kanish. As in, it wasn't until several weeks and pounds later that Peter's friends admitted that there was no such thing as the Kanish diet.
K-N-I-C-H.
No. Oh! I know, it's my people's food.
Kanish is spelled K-N-I-C-H. S-H.
Okay.
This one has a few pronunciations.
Oh, great.
Chitlins, chitterlins, or chitterlings.
Wait, so I didn't hear all of them because of the laughing, so.
Chitlins, chitterlins, chitterlings. The intestines of hogs prepared as food.
Chitlins. What was the other one?
Chitterling.
Chitterlin. Chitterling.
Chitterlins.
Chitterlins.
And chitterlings.
Chitterlings. Chitterlings. Chitterlins at the end, right?
There's chitlins.
Chitlins.
Chitterlins.
Chitterlins.
Chitterlings.
Chitterlings. Where is this from? Can we ask where this is from? Or in the or language
from the
of
South,
origin?
It's
I'm sorry.
Its origin is English. It's not a foreign.
I've only ever heard the first pronunciation, and I don't think I've ever seen it written down. All right. C-H-I... T T E R L I N G S.
Correct. Succotash.
Succotash. S U C C O T A S H.
Fajitas.
Fajitas. Say it with me now, kids. F-A-J-I-T-A-S, fajitas.
Correct. Okay. the end of round seven, we have journalists 40, lawmakers 18. No more themes. Well, not this round. What? Roulette.
Roulette, as in the game.
Yes, a gambling game.
R-O-U-L-E-T-T-E.
Correct. Impetus.
Impetus?
A driving or impelling force.
Okay, impetus. I am... P-E-T-U-S.
Gregarious.
What's the etymology?
It's from Latin. As in, Emily's gregarious Labrador greeted all her house guests while her cat slipped out of the room in search of some me time under the bed.
Gregarious. G-R-E-G-A-R-I-O-U-S.
Correct. Bandersnatch.
Oh, I'm so happy about this one. Because I learned this song when I was a kid. No, it's beware the jub jub bird and shun the frumious bandersnatch, right? Okay, this is Rudyard Kipling, right, okay. Sorry, I'm earning my nerdy roots. Anyway, I'm not trying, but bandersnatch, right?
Bandersnatch.
B-A-N-D-E-R-S-N-A-T-C-H.
Correct. Renegade.
Renegade, definition?
An individual who rejects the restraints of law or convention.
R-E-N-E-G-A-D-E.
Correct. Germaine.
Germaine, G-E-R-M-A-N-E, Germaine.
Correct. We haven't used it yet.
Five or eight.
Number five. There you go. Round eight. The end of round eight. We have journalists 45, lawmakers 19. We have another themed round for you. This is state birds, flowers, trees, or minerals.
There are state minerals? Really?
Apparently.
All right.
Ptarmigan.
What?
Ptarmigan.
Can I ask if it's a bird, mineral, flower?
Yes, it's any of the various grouses of northern regions having completely feathered feet. Ptarmigan, ptarmigan.
Can you say that one more time?
Ptarmigan, ptarmigan.
Ptarmigan. T-A-R-M-E-G-I-N.
ptarmigan is spelled P-T-A-R-M-I-G-A-N. Beryl. This beryl is a mineral consisting of a silicate of metallic elements of great hardness and occurring in green, bluish-green, yellow, pink, or white hexagonal prisms. As in David thought the pendant made of beryl matched his girlfriend's eyes beautifully, and more importantly, his budget.
A beryl, B-E-R-Y-L.
Correct. Azalea.
Azalea. Language of origin?
It's from an originally Greek word.
Azalea. Can you pronounce that one more time, please?
Azalea, sometimes azalea.
A-Z. A-L-E-A.
Very good. Yeah? Correct. Loblolly.
That's a fun sounding word. One more time, please.
Loblolly.
Loblolly.
It's a tall spreading pine of the central and southeastern United States.
Of course it is. Do people pronounce it any other way than loblolly?
I have just the one pronunciation, loblolly.
Who came up with the origins of this name?
Well, it's English.
It is?
Yes, came from an English word.
Loblolly. Loblolly. This sounds like you know, like the Bob blah blah thing? Sorry, but I'm not going to spell it that way. One more time?
Loblolly.
Loblolly. L-O-B-L-O-L-L-Y? Yes.
Correct. Sequoia.
Sequoia. S-E-Q-U-O-I-A.
This is getting very stressful.
Pheasant.
Pheasant.
As in, the pheasant benefited greatly from the vice
president. Do people still shoot pheasants? Is that like a thing people still do? I had a feeling. Pheasant. P-H-E-A-S-A-N-T, pheasant.
Correct. The end of round 9, we have journalists 49, lawmakers 20. Greiling. Connivory.
Can you use it in a sentence, please?
Alan suspects Brenda of connivory in the mysterious sale of the mansion.
And the language of origin?
The first part is from an originally Latin word. The second part is an English combining form.
Any alternate pronunciations?
I show just the one. Connivory.
Connivory. C-A-N-I-V-E-R-Y. No.
Oh. Sorry. Connivory is spelled C-O-N-N-I-V-E-R-Y. Y'all can move in if you want. Yeah. He won't bite.
It's a long walk.
Cholesterol, as in Jose described the secret ingredient of his potato gratin as a totally unreasonable amount of cholesterol.
Cholesterol, C-H-O-L-E-S-T-E-R-O-L.
Antagonist.
Antagonist, definition.
The principal opponent or foil of the main character in a drama or narrative.
Okay, antagonist. A-N-T-A-G-O-N-I-S-T.
Very good. Correct. Theoretician.
Can you repeat the word?
Theoretician, one who formulates beliefs, policies, or procedures proposed or followed as the basis of action. Theoretician.
Etymology?
It's from Greek.
Theoretician?
Theoretician.
Theoretician. T-H-E... Start over. Can you repeat the word?
Theoretician.
Theoretician. T-H-E-O-R. E-T-I-C-A-N.
Theoretician is spelled T-H-E-O-R-E-T-I-C-I-A-N.
Can I just say that the people who write those definitions are tremendous writers? Or the usage in a sentence or whatever it is, yeah.
That's not going to help you with the words.
Haven't missed one yet, Mr. Kaine.
But it will get you clemency.
Clemency? Clemency. C-L-E-M-E-N-C-Y.
End of round 10, we have journalists 51, lawmakers 21.
Okay.
Hegemony.
Hegemony, definition.
Preponderant influence or authority as of a government or state, leadership or dominance.
Origin language?
It's from Greek.
Hegemony, H-E-G-E-M-O-N-Y.
Amnesty.
Amnesty. is this for immigrants? Or,
I'm sorry?
Is this for immigrants?
Excuse me.
A-M-N-E-S-T-Y. Yay.
Jeopardize.
Jeopardize. J-E-O-P-A-R-D-I-Z-E.
Yeah.
Correct.
Messing around, I'm a big fan of yours, Mr. Kaine. That's a joke. I'm kidding.
Intractable.
Intractable? Intractable. I-N-T-R-A-C-T-A-B-L-E. Intractable.
Correct. End of round 11, journalists 54, lawmakers 22. Yeah. casuistry?
Okay. One more time.
Casuistry.
Casuistry? Am I saying that right? Casuistry?
Casuistry.
Casuistry. What does that mean?
Casuistry is the study of or the doctrine that deals with cases of conscience.
What's the language of origin?
It's from a word that went from Latin to Spanish to English.
Casuistry?
Casuistry.
And can you use it in a sentence to buy me some time?
To complete her degree in philosophy, Tisha had to take a semester of casuistry.
Y'all don't have to spell it, okay? Casuistry, and there are no other alternate pronunciations, right? Just casuistry? Casuistry?
Am I saying casuistry?
Casuistry, and I think I'm saying that close to correct. Okay. C-A-S-U-A-S-T-R-Y? Yeah, that was going to happen. What is it, though?
Casuistry is spelled C-A-S-U-I-S-T-R-Y.
Okay.
Leviathan.
Leviathan. L-E-V-I-A-T-H-A-N.
Nepotism.
Nepotism. N-E-P-O-T-I-S-M.
Amateurish.
Amateurish. A-M-A-T-E-U-R-I-S-H.
Yeah. End of round 12. Journalists, 56. Lawmakers, 23. Okay.
Talking about the last round and stuff, yeah.
Amalgam.
Amalgam? Also amalgam?
I have just the one. You might pronounce it that way. Okay. Amalgam. combination or mixture of different elements.
Yeah.
Cynthia's Pinterest board is an amalgam of rooftops, kale, mason jars, and inspirational quotes about Louboutins.
And it's from?
It's from a word that probably from an originally Arabic word, then it went to Latin, then French, then English.
Interesting. Okay. A-M-A-L-G-A-M?
Correct.
There you go.
Hypothesis.
Hypothesis. H-Y-P-O-T-H-E-S-I-S.
Gourmand.
Gourmand.
Gourmand, a luxurious eater, an epicure, a gourmet.
G-O-U-R-M-A-N-D.
Interstice.
Interstice.
It's a space that intervenes between one thing and another, a space between things that are closely set.
Okay, well, this is a guess. I-N-T-E-R-S-T-I-S.
Interstice is spelled I-N-T-E-R-S-T-I-C-E. End of round 13, journalists, 58, Lawmakers, 24.
New game, okay.
Nugacious. Nugacious means trifling or trivial.
Nugacious, and that's the only pronunciation?
There's nugacious and nugacious.
Sorry. Say that again. The
nugacious, nugacious.
Nugacious and nugacious. What's the language of origin?
Latin.
And trifling or trivial?
Yes, as in arguments about who sits in a vehicle's front seat seem nugacious to many adults.
Are they?
And there's no other questions I can ask, right?
Well,
about like
ask
parts of the words or like anything like that. What?
You can ask them all again.
Yeah, sure. No. Nugacious or nugacious. and it's you said it's English or what's the sorry?
It's from Latin.
Latin, right? Okay, so N U G A C I O U S.
Correct. Silhouette.
Silhouette. S I L H O U E T T E.
Correct. Hallucinogen.
Hallucinogen?
Hallucinogen, as in the senator's admission to experimenting with a hallucinogen, did cost him the election, but it won him a seat at the local drum circle.
Hallucinogen. H A L L U C I-N-E-G-O-N.
All right.
Hallucinogen spelled H-A-L-L-U-C-I-N-O-G-E-N. Cappuccino.
Do I know how to spell this word? Yeah. Cappuccino. I don't think I know how to spell this word. Hold on. C-A-P-U. C-C-I-N-O?
Correct. I'll clarify, there are actually two spellings of that word. They're both considered correct. Round 14, journalists 60, lawmakers 25. nomenclature.
Okay, definition and language of origin and sentences and stuff, but...
Nomenclature is originally from Latin, and nomenclature refers to the collective names given to or borne by places in a particular region or area, as in the nomenclature of Boston streets confused Ling when she first arrived.
Thank you for using my hometown in the example. I appreciate that. Nomenclature. N-O-M-E-N-C-L-A-T-U-R-E.
Yeah. Bustard.
Wow. Okay.
A bustard is any of several large, chiefly terrestrial game birds of the Old World and Australia that are related to cranes and plovers.
And language of origin?
It's originally Latin, it went to Italian, and then French, and then English. It's interesting that the endangered bustard is in the process of being reintroduced to Britain, where in 2009, two bustard chicks were hatched for the first time in 170 years.
I'm going to go with B-U-S-T-A-R-D.
Correct.
Filibuster, is that what they call it?
Hypocrisy.
Hypocrisy is spelled, I'm fairly certain it's spelled.
Do you want a sentence?
Yeah.
Hypocrisy is the act or practice of pretending to be what one is not.
I'm going to be really embarrassed if I misspell this word. Sorry, can you say that again?
Hypocrisy is the act or practice of pretending to be what one is not, or to have principles or beliefs that one does not have. As in, Jack admitted it was hypocrisy to carry around those biceps wherever he went and still be in favor of gun control.
I don't think I know the second letter to this word. H-Y-P-O-C-R-I-S-Y?
Correct. Round 15, journalists 62, lawmakers 26. Vitriolic.
What? Really, really madness. But tell me the definition and
vitriolic
language.
Means marked by a caustic biting quality.
And from?
It's from Latin, went through French before becoming English. It's usually used of speech.
It's usually used of what?
Speech. Vitriolic, as in Howard had to be reprimanded for his vitriolic outbursts against the referees and opposing players.
Vitriolic. V-I-T-R-I-O-L-I-C.
Mendacious.
And the definition?
Mendacious means given to deception or falsehood.
Mendacious. M-E-N-D-A-C-I-O-U-S.
Way more psychologically intense than I prepared myself for tonight.
Avuncular.
Avuncular. Latin origin, and there's like a weird consonant in that word. Excuse me, almost cursed. Can you use it in the sentence, please, sir?
The librarian was always avuncular in his dealings with young children.
Avuncular.
Hey. It means... Yeah.
U-V-U-N-C-U-L-A-R, avuncular.
Avuncular is spelled A-V-U-N-C-U-L-A-R. Round 16, journalists 63, lawmakers 27. Record desk, who goes first? You ready? Nope.
Yeah, no. We were
okay.
Just, yeah.
Amygdala.
Oh, like the thing in your brain, right?
Yes. It's the basal ganglion in each cerebral hemisphere that consists of an almond-shaped
mass. Yeah. And it's affected by too much pot smoke. I read about this recently. I have personal capacity, but it's in the news. It's true. It's various people I know, I can explain their personality disorders. amygdala, can you give me the language of origin?
Amygdala is from an originally Greek word that passed into Latin.
And you already used it in a sentence or not yet? You
just gave
me a definition. Please do.
Martin exercised his amygdala each morning by thinking of everything that could possibly go wrong that day.
Amygdala. A-M-Y-G-D-A-L-A.
Bergamot.
Bergamot?
Bergamot or bergamot.
Can you tell me what it means, please?
Bergamot is the oil expressed from the rind of a pear-shaped citrus fruit and used chiefly as a perfume. As in, the life coach's first order of business was to let Larry know he was overdoing it with the bergamot.
Cool. B-E-R-G-E-M-A-T.
It's Karoun, not Karen, just since I'm the last one up here, I'm going to correct everybody on that. But
how do you say
it? It's Karoun, not Karen. Yeah, okay. Karen's my mother. But
Karoun.
Yeah.
Okay. In order to be declared champion, you need to spell this next word correctly.
No pressure. Okay.
First, I should say that bergamot is spelled B-E-R-G-A-M-O-T.
Okay. Yeah, ready. I think, maybe. Just give me a word.
Impresario.
I was hoping for musical terms. Sort of. This is more theatrical, but yes. Impresario. Definition.
Impresario is the manager or conductor of an opera or concert company.
If I don't get this right, then all of my years and years and years of classical music training is going to be for naught. It's from Italian, right?
It's from Italian, yes.
And can you just use it in a sentence?
The impresario arranged for the opera company to perform in several cities. Impresario or impresario?
Okay.
I M P R E S S. It's one S, wasn't it? A R I O. Yep. But that means we're back on!
Contest rules at this point in time. Don is back in the competition. Spellers spell in their original order, which means Karoun.
Yes.
Damn it. Okay. Yes.
Impresario is.
I know
one
S. I got it.
One S. Coterie.
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 French.
Yes.
Definition.
Justine and her coterie arrived fashionably late to the gallery.
Sentence, please.
Jarvis wondered if his group could be called a coterie if its other members included a Lord of the Rings action figure, his poster of Han Solo, and his Bichon Frise sitting in the baby carriage.
Coterie. C-O-T-E-R-I-E.
Nonagesimal. Nonagesimal.
Can you use that in a sentence, please? How about coterie? I mean, I like coterie.
Pete knew he was the nonagesimal person in Carol's list of her 91 favorite people, but he was happy just to be mentioned.
Nonagesimal. N-O-N-A-G-E-S-I-M-A-L.
Correct. In case anybody's counting, round 19. Journalists, 65. Lawmakers, 28. Pinioned. Pinioned. Disabled or restrained by binding the arms to the body.
Language of origin?
The first part is from a French word that then became English. The second part is from an originally English word.
And in a sentence?
The rock star's bodyguards pinioned his attacker until the police arrived.
And there's no alternate pronunciations, right?
Just the one, pinioned.
And sorry, it's pinioned. We want
pinioned.
Past tense? Okay.
Yes, it's a verb, a past tense.
P-I-N-I-O-N-E-D.
Correct. Frugivore.
How about pinioned? Frugivore.
Frugivore.
Could you tell me what that means, please?
One that feeds on fruit.
Okay, I'll go with it. F-R-U-G-I-V-O-R-E.
Correct. Wow. Doppelganger.
Okay, I have a question on this, actually, because this comes from German, right? So if you have a letter that has an umlaut in German, do you add an E or not in... or does it matter? Are there two acceptable ways? Like, can you spell it with the A umlaut, or can you have to put an AE to, like, compensate for that in English?
Judges?
Okay, go ahead. We see two acceptable spellings.
You see two acceptable spellings there. Yes. Okay, so doppelganger?
Doppelganger.
The, like, definition, just to make sure.
A doppelganger is a living person that closely resembles another living person.
Okay. I, okay, if there's two acceptable spellings, then D O P P E L G A. You could put an E in here if you wanted to. N G E R.
Correct. Risible.
Risible. It's a R-I-S-I-B-L-E.
Correct.
The answer is so quickly.
Plantagenet.
Again.
Plantagenet.
Plantagenet. Definition.
A member of an English royal family to which belonged the rulers of England from 1154 to 1485. 1154 to 1485.
Plantagenet?
Plantagenet.
And did they have a reason that they were called that? No? Okay. Did
Not
they ever make sentences about themselves?
Did
anybody ever write a sentence about them?
Oh, yes. Prince Charles was glad that Kate Middleton decided against naming the baby Plantagenet and went with Charlotte.
And sorry, the definition was that is the name or that's of the family?
The definition of Plantagenet is a member of an English royal family to which belonged the rulers of England from 1154 to 1485. Plantagenet.
And it's just an English word, right? Old English word?
Yes. The missing remains of Richard III, the last Plantagenet king, were found in 2012 buried under a parking lot.
I have no idea. So I heard about that story, but I still don't know how to spell this guy's name. P-L-A-N-T-A-G-I-N-A-T-E?
To be declared champion, Don, you will have to spell the next two words correctly.
That's fair. That's fair.
But Plantagenet is spelled P-L-A-N-T-A-G-E-N-E-T. Vermicide.
Vermicide. Is it country of origin or language of origin?
It's from two Latin elements. It means an agent that destroys worms, especially those that are intestinally parasitic.
Okay. Vermicide, V-E-R-M-I-C-I-D-E.
Yeah. Apostasy.
Apostasy. Apostasy, A-P. O-S-T-A-S-Y.
Yeah. You are the champion.
I have a rules inquiry. I have a rules inquiry. Is Congressman Beyer the individual champion?
Yes.
And what is the team score? No, no, wait.
Journalists, 67. Lawmakers, 32.
If Don Beyer spells the next 36 words in a row correctly, is there a chance that our team can still be successful?
Judges?
No, the audience looks like they're ready for the open bar. Okay.